بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. رب يسر ولا تعسر وتمم بالخير وبك نستعين يا فتاح. اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا علما. الحمد لله على كل حال ونعوذ بالله من حال أهل النار. اللهم زيننا بالحلم وأكرمنا بالتقوى وجملنا بالعافية. اللهم نور قلوبنا بالقرآن وزين أخلاقنا بزينة القرآن ونجنا من النار بالقرآن وأدخلنا الجنة بشفاعة القرآن. اللهم فقهنا في الدين وعلمنا التأويل. اللهم فقهنا في الدين وعلمنا التأويل. اللهم فقهنا في الدين وعلمنا التأويل. وصلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه محمد وآله وصحبه أجمعين. As we all know, inshallah, we will start the tafsir of Surah Yasin from today. This will be a tafsir series for 5 weeks. Surah Yasin is the 36th chapter of the Quran, containing 83 verses and 5 ruku's. So inshallah, we will try to cover one ruku every week, inshallah. As we all know, Surah Yasin is one of the most virtuous surahs in the Quran. And it is also one of the most oft-read surahs in the Quran by the Muslims. And that is why it is very important that while we recite this surah, we should be able to understand the meaning of this surah and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us. So this surah has many names. Yasin is not the only name of this surah. One name of this surah is Suratul Mu'imma. Mu'imma means a surah that covers and gathers good and blessings for its reader. Both blessings of the dunya and the akhirah. So a person who recites Surah Yasin, he will get the good, he will get good and blessings of the dunya and akhirah. And another name of this surah is Suratun Dafi'atun, a surah that removes calamities from its reciter. And another name of this surah is Suratun Qadiyatun, a surah that fulfills the needs of its reader. In one hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrated, which comes in Mishkat al-Masabih, "Man qara'a Yasin fi sadri an-nahar qudiyat hawa'ijuhu," aw kama qala alayhi salatu wassalam, that whosoever recites Surah Yasin in the beginning of the day, all of his needs are fulfilled. So one of the names of this surah is Suratul Qadiyah, a surah that fulfills a person's needs. And another name of this surah is Suratun Azima, the great surah. It is a very great surah containing many great meanings in it. And it is also famously known as the heart of the Quran, because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrated in a hadith that comes in the Sunan of Imam Tirmidhi by Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna li kulli shay'in qalban, وقلب القرآن سورة ياسين." That every single thing has a heart, and the heart of the Quran is Surah Yasin. And why is this surah called the heart of the Quran? So some mufassirin have said that because it contains all of the three essential themes of the Quran, and that is إثبات التوحيد والرسالة والآخرة. It proves the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the prophethood of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it proves the existence of the hereafter. And Imam Ghazali rahimahullah wrote that the reason why Surah Yasin is called the heart of the Quran is because Surah Yasin focuses on the belief of the Akhirah. And Iman bil Akhirah is such an important thing in our lives that a person who has true concern in the Akhirah, so this true concern in the Akhirah will lead a person to do good deeds and stay away from sins. وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَىٰ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Nazi'at that person who fears standing in front of his Lord, وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ, and as a result of him fearing, standing before his Lord, he refrains and he prevents his nafs from fulfilling its unlawful desires. فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَىٰ, the ultimate abode of this person will be paradise and Jannah. So because in this surah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in detail proves the existence of the Akhirah and the importance of the Akhirah with a lot of eloquency, that is why this surah is known as the heart of the Quran. Because the soundness of the body depends on the soundness of the heart. And sihatul qalb, the soundness of the heart, depends on having true concern of the Akhirah. So a person who has true concern of the Akhirah, he will try to rectify himself and purify himself. So that is why Imam Ghazali rahimahullah says that Surah Yasin is called the heart and the qalb of the Quran. Now, this surah obviously contains many specialities in it. And inshallah, I will try my best to briefly cover one ruku every week, inshallah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts off this surah by saying, Yasin wal Qur'an al-Hakim. Now Yasin, according to majority of the Mufassireen, is from the huruf muqatta'at. The huruf muqatta'at are disjointed letters. There are 29 surahs in the Quran that start with huruf muqatta'at. And the Mufassireen in their books of tafsir, wherever the huruf muqatta'at comes, they say Allahu a'lamu bi muradihi. Allah well knows the meaning of this. That is, the meaning of the huruf muqatta'at is only known by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is not known by anyone else. Now the question might arise that what is the benefit of the huruf muqatta'at when we do not even know the meaning of it? So Ibn Kathir rahimahullah writes in his tafsir that if we look at all of the 29 surahs that start with the huruf muqatta'at, after mentioning the huruf muqatta'at, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of the Qur'an or the verses of the Qur'an. For example, Alif Lam Mim, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. So in Alif Lam Mim, right after mentioning the huruf muqatta'at, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the Qur'an. طَاسِين, تِلْكَ آيَاتُ الْقُرْآنِ وَكِتَابٍ مُبِينٍ. طَاسِين مِيم, تِلْكَ آيَاتُ الْكِتَابِ الْمُبِينٍ. حَامِيم, تَنْزِيلٌ مِّنَ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ. أَلِفْ لَام مِّيم رَا, تِلْكَ آيَاتُ الْكِتَابِ. So whichever surah starts with the huruf muqatta'at, we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions either the verses of the Qur'an or he mentions the Qur'an itself. So Ibn Kathir rahimahullah writes that the purpose of revealing the huruf muqatta'at was to challenge the Arabs at that time, that despite them being very eloquent in the Arabic language and despite them being able to compose many lines of poetry on the spot, but they became helpless in producing anything similar to the huruf muqatta'at. Whereas the huruf muqatta'at are just basic alphabets that have been put together. But no one knows the meaning of these huruf muqatta'at. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to show them that despite you being so eloquent in the Arabic language, you are not even able to understand a few alphabets that have been put together. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, He challenged the entire humanity to try to produce a single chapter like the Quran. First, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenged the Arabs and the humanity in general. فَأَتُوا بِعَشْرِ سُوَرٍ مِثْلِهِ مُفْتَرَيَاتٍ وَدْعُوا مَنِ اسْتَطَعْتُم مِّن دُونِ اللَّهِ إِن كُنتُم صَادِقِينَ. That if you are true in your claim that the Quran is not a divine revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and it is the kalam and the speech of the creation, then bring 10 chapters and 10 surahs like the Quran. So this was the first challenge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to the humanity. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the verse, وَإِن كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّن مِثْلِهِ وَدُعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِّن دُونِ اللَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. that if you have doubt in what we have revealed to our servant, then try to bring a surah the like of it. وَدْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ And call your witnesses and your helpers besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you are true in your claim that this is the kalam and the speech of the creation. That when you finish composing a single chapter like the Qur'an, call your witnesses to show that this is a chapter that is similar to the Qur'an. And in Surah Bani Israel, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ لَإِنِ اجْتَمَعَتِ الْإِنسُ وَالْجِنُّ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَأْتُوا بِمِثْلِ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ لَا يَأْتُونَ بِمِثْلِهِ وَلَوْ كَانَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ ظَهِيرًا That say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if the entire humanity and the entire jinn, they come together and they help one another to try to produce a single chapter like the Qur'an, لَا يَأْتُونَ بِمِثْلِهِ They will not be able to produce a single chapter like the Qur'an, وَلَوْ كَانَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ ظَهِيرًا Even if they help one another in trying to compose a single chapter like the Qur'an. So this was the second challenge that was given. The first challenge was try to bring 10 surahs. The second challenge was try to bring at least one surah. And the final challenge was فَأْتُوا بِآيَةٍ إِن كُنْتَ مِنَ الصَّادِقِينَ إِن كُنْتُم مِنَ الصَّادِقِينَ Bring a single verse like the Qur'an if you are true in the claiming that the Qur'an is not the word of Allah. So the purpose of the Huruf Muqatta'at was to show their helplessness in even trying to understand few alphabets that were put together. Until today, no one knows the true meaning of the Huruf Muqatta'at besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is one of the tafsirs of Yasin. And as Ibn Kathir rahimahullah mentioned that in the 29 chapters that start with the Huruf Muqatta'at, immediately in the following verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the Qur'an. So in this verse also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالْقُرْآنِ الْحَكِيمِ By the oath of the all-wise Qur'an. And the second tafsir of Yasin is that Yasin means O human. And those of us who are acquainted with the Arabic language, we know that sometimes we take a word and we abbreviate it. So Yasin is the abbreviated form, the mukhaffaf of insanun. So Yasin means O human being, O the perfect human being, Ya Sayyid al-Bashar, O the leader of the humanity, referring to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he was the most complete and perfect human being. The third tafsir of Yasin is that Yasin is one of the names of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And some of the mufassirin who took this tafsir, their proof is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in reply to this oath, says, إِنَّكَ لَمِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ عَلَىٰ صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam directly by saying, Verily you are from among the messengers and you are upon the straight path. So that is why some of the Mufassirin have said that Yasin is one of the names of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the final tafsir of Yasin is that according to Imam Malik rahimahullah and some other tabi'in, they say that Yasin is one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if we take this tafsir into consideration, then a very important mas'ala will come about. And that is that is it permissible to name someone Yasin? Because Yasin is one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala according to Imam Malik rahimahullah. So that is why it comes in some of the books of fiqh that according to Imam Malik rahimahullah, it is not permissible to name someone Yasin. Because Yasin is one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah is the actual name of Allah. Allah is the ismu dhat of Allah. And Rahman is treated like the ismu dhat of Allah, at the same time it is also an attribute of Allah. But these two words cannot be used for the makhluq, Allah and Rahman. And there are some attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that can be used for the creation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used some of those attributes for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Qur'an. When he said in Surah Yunus, in Surah Tawbah, in the closing verses of Surah Tawbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِتُّمْ حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. That verily a prophet has come to you from among yourselves. عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِتُّمْ. Your being in difficulty is hard for him to bear. حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ. And he is greedy and he has severe desire for what is good for you. بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. And he is very kind and merciful to the believers. And those of us who know the 99 names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we know that Ra'uf and Rahim are one of the attributes and one of the 99 beautiful names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But these two attributes have been used for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So from this verse, the Mufassirin deduced that those attributes that are not exclusive to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can be used for the makhluq. Now, if we say that Yasin is one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we first have to know what Yasin means. So Imam Malik rahimahullah says that we do not know the exact meaning of Yasin. So there is a possibility that Yasin can signify a attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is exclusive to him, like Khaliq and Raziq. Khaliq and Raziq, the creator and the provider, the sustainer. These are also attributes and names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they are such attributes that are exclusive to Allah. Allah is the only one who creates, and Allah is the only true Raziq. إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينَ. So that is why, according to Imam Malik rahimahullah, to keep the name Yasin is not permissible. And but at the same time, he did give us an alternative. It comes in the books of fiqh that if a person keeps the name Yasin, that Imam Malik rahimahullah says that when he writes his name in Arabic, he should write the Ya and the Sin separately. I mean, if we look at the slide, we'll see that Yasin, the Ya and the Sin is written together. So a person should write the Ya separately, meaning he should spell out the Ya, Ya, Alif, and then Sin, Ya Sakina, and then the Noon. So if a person keeps the name Yasin, then according to Imam Malik, when he writes the name in Arabic, he should write out and spell out Ya Sin. Then it will not become an exclusive name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because in Surah Safat, there is a verse wherein Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Salamun ala Ilyasin. May peace be upon Ilyas alayhi salam. So Ilyas alayhi salam was one of the great prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And another way of mentioning or saying his name is Ilyasin by adding a ya and noon at the end. So we can say Ilyas and Ilyasin. So in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala referred to him as Ilyasin. And this is how we normally read the Qur'an. We read the Qur'an according to the qira'ah of Imam Asim, according to the riwayah of Imam Hafs. So according to the riwayah of Imam Hafs, we read Salamun ala Ilyasin. But in some other qira'ats and recitations, it comes Salamun ala Ali Yasin. May peace be upon the family of Yasin. So another name of Ilyas alayhi salam was Yasin. So taking that qira'ah into consideration, Imam Malik rahimahullah says that Yasin was also the name of a prophet that is mentioned in the Quran. But if we see this verse in the Quran, then we'll see that the Ya and the Sin are spelled out. They are not written like how the Yasin is written in this surah. So that is where Imam Malik rahimahullah takes his ruling from. So nevertheless, whatever tafsir we take into consideration, the first tafsir is the preferred tafsir according to most of the mufassirin, that Yasin is from amongst the huruf muqatta'at. Wal Qur'an al-Hakim, by the oath of the Qur'an that is full of wisdom. Hakim ay zi hikmatin. So the word Hakim comes from the root word hikmah, full of wisdom. Now, إِنَّكَ لَمِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. This is the reply of the oath. إِنَّكَ لَمِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ عَلَىٰ صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. Verily you are among the prophets and you are upon the straight path. So, wal Qur'an al-Hakim, the oath is actually the proof of the reply of the oath. That is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens the surah by refuting those who deny the prophethood of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Allah says, wal Qur'an al-Hakim, by the oath of the Qur'an that is full of wisdom, innaka lamin al-mursaleen, verily you are among the prophets. That is, the wal Qur'an al-Hakim, the Qur'an being full of wisdom, is a sign and is a proof that you are the prophet of Allah. Because we all know that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was intentionally made unlettered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that no one can say that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he wrote the Qur'an or he came up with the Qur'an on his own. So the fact that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was unlettered, and yet we see that the Qur'an is a fountain of wisdom, and the Qur'an is full of wisdom. So this is a proof that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not fabricate the Qur'an, but rather the Qur'an is the word of Allah. So wal Qur'an al-Hakim is the proof of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam being a prophet. So this is one of the translations of wal Qur'an al-Hakim, and this is the normal common translation that we will find in the books of translation. But another translation of Al Quran al Hakim is Wal Quran al Muhkam. And we have some of our students sitting here. So those of us who have studied some Arabic grammar, we will understand why Wal Quran al Hakim is being translated as Wal Quran al Muhkam. So if we take the second translation into consideration, Wal Quran al Hakim would mean the Qur'an that is solid and precise and accurate. Because a noun that comes in the pattern of fa'ilun gives the meaning of maf'ulun. So ahkama yuhkimu ihkaman means to solidify. Muhkam is something that is solidified, something that is made solid. So wal Qur'an al-Hakim would mean the solid, accurate, precise Qur'an. That is, the Qur'an has been solidified from being altered and from having any contradiction, and it is perfect both from a linguistic perspective and both from a meaning perspective. There is no deficiency found in the Quran, both in the alfaz of the Quran and both in the ma'ani and the meaning of the Quran. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means when he says, لَا يَأْتِيهِ الْبَاطِلُ مِنْ بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَلَا مِنْ خَلْفِهِ تَنْزِيلُ مِنْ حَكِيمٍ حَمِيدٍ. That falsehood cannot reach the Qur'an from in front and from behind. تَنْزِيلُ مِنْ حَكِيمٍ حَمِيدٍ. This is a book that has been revealed from the being who is all-wise and praiseworthy. وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if the Qur'an if the Qur'an was revealed by anyone besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then the people would have found many contradictions in the Qur'an. So there is no actual contradiction in the Qur'an. Whatever contradiction we might find in the Qur'an are only apparent contradictions which have been answered by the mufassirin in their books of tafsir. So if we take the second meaning into consideration, Wal Qur'an al-Hakim would mean by the oath of the solid and precise and accurate Qur'an, verily you are among the prophets. So the fact that the Qur'an is so accurate and precise and so full of wisdom, this is a sign that you are the prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. عَلَىٰ صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. You are upon the straight path. This verse and this sentence is an emphasis of the previous verse. Apparently there was no need to bring ala sirati mustaqim, because a person who is a prophet, obviously he is upon the straight path. So ala sirati mustaqim was brought to emphasize the previous sentence and to give the meaning that you are upon the straight path, therefore whoever follows you will be regarded to be on the straight path. Whoever follows you will be regarded to be rightly guided, will be regarded to have true guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whoever follows a path other than your path, he may regard himself to be guided, but he is not guided in the path, in the state of Allah. الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعْيُهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ يَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ يُحْسِنُونَ صُنْعًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Surah Al-Kahf that, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, say, هَلْ نُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِالْأَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالًا. Should we inform you of the person who is the greatest loser? الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعْيُهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ يَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ يُحْسِنُونَ صُنْعًا. It is those individuals whose effort in this world go in vain, go useless, are of no benefit to them. وَهُمْ يَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ يُحْسِنُونَ صُنْعًا. But they regard themselves to be doing good actions, and they regard themselves to be on the right path. So everyone who is following any religion, he is following that religion because he regards that religion to be the truth, and he regards himself to be on the straight path. But the Quran tells us that the only path of true guidance is the path of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. قُلْ كُلُّ يَعْمَلُ عَلَى شَاكِلَتِهِ فَرَبُّكُمْ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنْ هُوَ أَهْدَى سَبِيلًا. In Surah Bani Israel, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, say, everyone is practicing upon their own way and their own religion, and everyone regards themselves to be truly guided. فَرَبُّكُمْ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنْ هُوَ أَهْدَى سَبِيلًا. But your Lord is the only one who knows who is actually on the straight path. إِنَّ رَبَّكَ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنْ ضَلَّ عَنْ سَبِيلِهِ وَهُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنْ اِهْتَدَى. Verily your Lord knows well who is on the straight path and who has gone astray. إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَهُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِالْمُهْتَدِينَ. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you cannot guide whoever you want and whoever you wish. Allah guides whoever He wants. وَهُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِالْمُهْتَدِينَ. And Allah is all-knowing of those who are on the straight path. So, ala sirati mustaqim, the purpose of this is to show that Rasulullah ﷺ is on the straight path, and whoever follows him is on the straight path. And the path that Rasulullah ﷺ calls towards is also the straight path. وَإِنَّكَ لَتَهْدِي إِلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ صِرَاطِ اللَّهِ الَّذِي لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ أَلَا إِلَى اللَّهِ تَصِيرُ الْأُمُورِ. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, verily you guide to the straight path, the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to who belongs everything that is in the heavens and in the earth. So from this we understand that ala sirati mustaqim was not brought as an extra sentence. It has some benefit to it. Otherwise, the objection arises that apparently there was no need to bring ala sirati mustaqim. After refuting, or after proving the prophethood of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refutes the claim of those who deny the divine nature of the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Tanzeel al-Aziz al-Rahim. It is a revelation from the Almighty and the All-Merciful. That is, the Quran is the word of Allah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used two of his attributes, Al-Aziz, the Almighty, and Al-Rahim, the All-Merciful, indicating that those who deny the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can punish them whenever He wants, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show His ultimate mercy to those who accept the Quran to be His divine revelation. لِتُنذِرَ قَوْمًا مَا أُنذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ فَهُمْ غَافِلُونَ. In this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the purpose of the prophethood and the purpose of the Qur'an. لِتُنذِرَ قَوْمًا مَا أُنذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ فَهُمْ غَافِلُونَ. So that you can warn that nation whose forefathers have not been warned. And as a result of this, they became negligent. There is one objection that arises in this verse. From this verse, apparently, we come to know that no nadir, no prophet was sent to the Arabs. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to the Arabs when He says, لِتُنذِرَ قَوْمًا مَا أُنذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ فَهُمْ غَافِلُونَ. And We all know that the Prophet of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was universal. He was not sent to only the Arabs and only to the Arab Peninsula. He was sent as a prophet to the entire humanity. قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ جَمِيعًا. Allah says in the Quran, O human beings, O Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, say, O human beings, verily I am the prophet of Allah to all of you. So, إِنِّي تُنْذِرَ قَوْمًا مَا أُنْذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that the purpose of sending Rasulullah as a prophet is to warn the Arabs. And the reason for this is the initial addressees of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam's message were the Arabs. That is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this. And it is from the Arabs and from the Sahaba that Islam spread to the non-Arabs. And then by the efforts of the Muslims of every era and through their da'wah and their efforts, Islam reached us. So in لِتُنْذِرَ قَوْمًا مَا أُنْذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ, the objection that arises is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَإِمْ مِنْ أُمَّةٍ إِلَّا خَلَى فِيهَا نَذِيرٌ. There is no nation but that a warner, a prophet came to them. وَلِكُلِّ قَوْمٍ هَادٍ. In another verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, for every nation, for every community, there is someone to guide them. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in another verse in Surah Bani Israel, وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا. We will not punish any nation until we first send a prophet to them. So in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that لِتُنْذِرَ قَوْمًا مَا أُنْذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ, that you warn a nation, a community, whose forefathers have not been warned. So the apparent meaning of this verse is that no nadir, no prophet was sent to the Arabs. So there is a contradiction between this verse and the three verses that I have just quoted. So one of the answers that the Mufassirin have given is that, and this is when we will truly appreciate the Arabic language. In order to truly understand the Quran and Hadith, a person has to master the Arabic language. So one of the answers that the Mufassirin have given is لِتُنْذِرَ قَوْمًا مَا أُنْذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ فَهُمْ غَافِلُونَ. So some of the Mufassirin say this, that this ma is not nafiya. This ma is not a particle of negation. This ma is mausula, or this ma is mustariya. And our students who are sitting in this gathering, they will understand what I'm saying. So ma is mausula or mustariya. What this means is that if we regard ma to be mausula, then the translation will be different. Then the translation will be لِتُنْذِرَ قَوْمًا الَّذِينَ أُنْذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ, so that you can warn that nation whose forefathers have been warned by prophets prior to you. And if we regard the ma to be mustariya, then the translation will be لِتُنْذِرَ قَوْمًا إِنْذَارَ مِثْلَ مَا أُنْذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ, so that you can warn the nation who have been warned before. You warn them like how they were warned before. So if we take this meaning into consideration, there is no contradiction whatsoever. Because then it means that you should warn a nation who has already been warned by prophets before them. Because the Arabs were from the progeny of Ibrahim, alayhi salam, and from the progeny of Ismail, alayhi salam. And all of the prophets who came were basically from the family and from the progeny of Ibrahim, alayhi salam. That is why Ibrahim, alayhi salam, was known as Abul Anbiya, the father of all the prophets. So if we take this meaning into consideration, it means that their forefathers were warned by the prophets who came before Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But this tafsir has not been accepted by majority of the mufassirin, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says fahum ghafilun. As a result of this, they became negligent. And those of us who studied the Arabic language, we would know that in fa, this the harf fa over here comes to give the meaning of natija. Fa tafri'iyya is a fa that comes to give the meaning of the result or the outcome of something. So fahum ghafilun would mean that as a result of this, they became negligent. So obviously, being warned by prophets is not a cause of being negligent. It should be the cause of being, of not being negligent. So that is why majority of the Mufassirin have said that this ma is nafiya and this ma came for negation. So then, what answer do the Mufassirin give to لِتُنذِرَ قَوْمًا مَا أُنذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ? So the answer that they give is that after Ibrahim and Ismail alayhi salam, for many centuries, no prophet was sent to the Arabs. And the prophets who came after Ibrahim alayhi salam were from the Bani Israel, and they were primarily sent to the Bani Israel. Because we know that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa is the only prophet who was sent to the entire humanity. All the other prophets were sent to specific nations. Some were sent to even a single tribe. So the other prophets who came after Ismail alayhi salam, they were initially and primarily sent to the Bani Israel. They were not specifically sent to the Arabs. And there was a gap of 600 years between the ascension of Isa alayhi salam to the heavens and the prophethood of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So there was a gap of 600 years when there was no prophet at all. And it is this time and era in Islamic history that is known as Asrul Jahiliyyah, the day of ignorance. So this was a time when the entire humanity was in utter ignorance and they were doing the inhuman things. And we all know the history of the Arabs and what they were doing at that time. They used to drink blood, eat dead animals. They used to bury their daughters alive and do so many other evil things. So again, if we take this explanation into consideration, it still does not remove the objection that وَإِن مِّنْ أُمَّةٍ إِلَّا خَلَى فِيهَا نَذِيرٌ, every nation has to have a warner. So the answer that is given by the Mufassirin is that it is not befitting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to not send any prophet to the Arabs. So if we study history, we'll know that even in this era, the Asrul Jahiliyyah, when there was no prophet sent, there were still some individuals who were practicing the true religion of Islam, and they were known as the Hunafa, those who separated themselves from the false religion and they submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the true religion. So they were not prophets, but they used to propagate the message of the prophets. So they were like na'ibin, and they were like representatives of the prophets alayhi salam. But obviously, the da'wah of a non-prophet is not like the da'wah of a prophet. That is why in this verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لِتُنذِرَ قَوْمًا مَا أُنذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ فَهُمْ غَافِلُونَ. And secondly, this objection will be removed by saying that to say that no prophet was not sent to the Arabs is incorrect, because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was sent to the Arabs. So in لِتُنذِرَ قَوْمًا مَا أُنذِرَ آبَاؤُهُمْ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not referring to their forefathers of the far past, he is referring to their forefathers of the near past. So if we take this into consideration, then inshallah, there will be no objection. لَقَدْ حَقَّ الْقَوْلُ عَلَىٰ أَكْثَرِهِمْ فَهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. So in the previous verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that the purpose of sending you a prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to warn your nation of the punishment of Allah if they do not accept iman. So obviously there were some who accepted iman and there were many who did not accept iman. Majority of the people did not accept iman. So we have to understand the purpose of this verse. لَقَدْ حَقَّ الْقَوْلُ عَلَىٰ أَكْثَرِهِمْ فَهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. The decree of Allah has been passed regarding most of them, therefore they will not bring iman, they will not accept iman. So apparently this verse is telling us that they were destined not to accept iman, they were destined to die upon kufr. So because they were destined to die upon kufr, so whether you warn them or not, they will have no benefit, they will die upon kufr. So apparently it seems as if them dying upon kufr is not their fault. Na'udhu billah. It is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed them to die on kufr, that is why they died on kufr. So that is why it is very important to understand the purpose behind the revelation of verses. And the purpose behind a text in the Quran and Hadith, what purpose does it convey? So according to the Usuliyin, this is referred to as Ibaratun Nas. Ibaratun Nas is the actual purpose behind the text of the Nusus of the Quran and Hadith. So we have to understand what is the purpose of this verse. The purpose of this verse is to console Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you have been sent to warn your nation and to bring them upon iman and to bring them close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but unfortunately there will still be many people who will not accept iman. So as a result of them not accepting iman, do not become too sad and do not become too depressed. Because this is what Rasulullah used to go through when he would see anyone not accepting iman and dying on kufr. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would see that the people are not accepting his message, he would go into a state of deep depression, to such an extent that there was fear of him dying out of depression. That is why one of the masnoon du'as that Rasulullah taught us is, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min mawti al-hammi wal-gham. Wa Allah, I seek your protection from dying out of depression. So Rasulullah's depression was not because of any worldly reason, it was because many of his followers were not accepting iman. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned this in the Quran. فَلَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعٌ نَفْسَكَ عَلَىٰ آثَارِهِمْ إِلَّمْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِهَذَا الْحَدِيثِ أَسَفًا. That فَلَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعٌ نَفْسَكَ أَلَّا يَكُونُوا مُؤْمِنِينَ. It seems as if you will kill yourself because they are not accepting iman. So because Rasulullah ﷺ used to go into a deep state of depression, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent many verses time after time to console Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you should not become too sad. It was not meant for them to accept iman. So the purpose of this verse is to console Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that is why one of the hikmahs and one of the wisdoms of revealing the Quran gradually in a span of 23 years and not revealing the Quran all at once was that time after time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could console Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is one of the purposes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah Al-Furqan. وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ جُمْلَةً وَاحِدًا. One of the objections that the kuffar used to make, that the disbelievers used to make, is that if this Quran is actually the word of Allah, then why was this Quran not sent at one time? Why was it gradually sent down? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replied by saying, كَذَٰلِكَ لِنُثَبِّتَ بِهِ. We sent the Quran gradually, لِنُثَبِّتَ بِهِ, to strengthen your heart with the verses of the Quran. Because time after time there was a need for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reveal verses to console Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when we read verses like this, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that it is meant for most of them not to accept iman, there are many verses like this in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَلِيلًا مَا تَذَكَّرُونَ قَلِيلًا مَا تَشْكُرُونَ قَلِيلًا مَا تُؤْمِنُونَ. Very few of you take heed from the advice of the Quran. Very few of you accept iman. Very few of you are grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is one of the translations of قَلِيلًا مَا تَشْكُرُونَ. The translation that I've made is taking into consideration that ma is in the meaning of man. Otherwise, there's another translation of these three verses also. And in many places, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَكْثَرُهُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ لَآيَةً وَمَا كَانَ أَكْثَرُهُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ Most of them will not accept iman. وَمَا أَكْثَرُ النَّاسِ وَلَوْ حَرَصْتَ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ Most of them will not accept iman even if you severely desire them to accept iman. It is not meant for them to accept iman. وَلَوْ شِئْنَا لَآتَيْنَا كُلَّ نَفْسٍ هُدَاهَا وَلَكِنْ حَقَّ الْقَوْلُ مِنِّي لَأَمْلَأَنَّ جَهَنَّمَ مِنَ الْجِنَّةِ وَالنَّاسِ أَجْمَعِينَ If we wanted, we could have given guidance to everyone. But وَلَكِنْ حَقَّ الْقَوْلُ مِنِّي But a decree has been passed from us that I have to fill Jahannam up with you, O Shaytan, and anyone who follows you. So when we read verses like this, وَلَقَدْ ضَلَّ قَبْلَهُمْ أَكْثَرُ الْأَوَّلِينَ Most of the people before you, the nations before you, most of the people were astray and did not accept iman. So when we read verses like this, Shaytan, he puts waswasa in our hearts and he tells us that if majority of the people are meant not to accept iman, then why is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent prophets, and why is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making life so difficult for us when it is decreed for us not to accept iman? And these are common objections that non-Muslims will make when they read the Quran. When they read verses like this, and they see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself is saying that it is decreed from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for them not to accept iman, so naturally the question will arise that if Allah did not want me to accept iman, then why is He putting me into the hellfire? So that is why I mentioned that we have to understand the purpose of these verses. The purpose of these verses is not to show that they are forced to die upon kufr, upon disbelief. The purpose of these verses are to console Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is basically consoling Rasulullah by telling him that because most of them have been decreed not to accept iman, that is why do not grieve and do not be sad if they do not accept iman. إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا فِي أَعْنَاقِهِمْ أَغْلَالًا فَهِيَ إِلَى الْأَذْقَانِ فَهُمْ مُقْمَحُونَ Verily, we shall place yokes on their necks which will reach their chins, because of which their heads will always be looking upwards. Their eyes and heads will be upwards. وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْ بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ سَدًّا وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ سَدًّا فَأَغْشَيْنَاهُمْ فَهُمْ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ And we shall place a barrier in front of them and a barrier behind them. And we shall veil them so that they may not see. So these two verses are connected with one another. According to Imam Qurtubi rahimahullah, this will be the condition of the disbelievers in Jahannam. And he deduces this tafsir from a verse in Surah Al-Mu'min, wherein Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِذِ الْأَغْلَالُ فِي أَعْنَاقِهِمْ وَالسَّلَاسِلْ يُسْحَبُونَ فِي الْحَمِيمِ ثُمَّ فِي النَّارِ يُسْجَرُونَ That in Jahannam, there will be yokes and chains on their necks. يُسْحَبُونَ فِي الْحَمِيمِ They will be dragged into boiling hot water. ثُمَّ فِي النَّارِ يُسْجَرُونَ And thereafter, they will be cast into the hellfire, and they will be used as fuel to kindle the hellfire. So Imam Qurtubi rahimahullah took the tafsir or the ayah of Surah Al-Mu'min and he said that this will be the condition in the Akhirah. And وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْ بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ سَدًّا وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ سَدًّا فَأَغْشَيْنَاهُمْ فَهُمْ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ basically means that they will be blind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take away their eyesight. So this is one of the tafsirs. And the other tafsir is that this is referring to an incident that took place with some of the kuffar and the mushrikeen in this world. So there is a story that has been mentioned by the author of Ruh al-Ma'ani, Allama Alusi al-Baghdadi rahimahullah. He mentions that once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was performing salah in the Al-Masjid al-Haram, and Abu Jahl, he intended to kill Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam while he was in sujood. So he took a big rock, and as he was approaching Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he raised his hand to throw the rock at Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's head, his hand got stuck to his neck, and he could not release his hand from his neck. So this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to when he says, "Inna ja'alna fi a'naqihim aghlalan." It is the author Ruh al-Ma'ani says that if we take this into consideration, then this verse will be we'll take this in a metaphorical sense. So the whole story goes that Abu Jahl, he tried to kill Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but his hand got stuck to his neck. He came back, and then another person went. He took the rock and he wanted to kill Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And as he was intending to hit Rasulullah with the rock, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him blind. Then the third person took the rock from him, and he approached Rasulullah. As he was about to hit Rasulullah, he saw a very big camel that was ready to devour him. And then out of fear, he just ran away. So this is one of the tafsirs, but this tafsir is extremely weak, and majority of the mufassirin have denied it. And the third tafsir, which is the most accepted and common tafsir of this verse, of these two verses, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is given an example of their condition. Allah is given a similitude of their farness from iman. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning that their condition of being far from iman is as if we placed a yoke on their neck, which is reaching their chin. And فَهُمْ مُقْمَحُونَ, because of which their heads are looking upward. So they are basically being choked. They are being choked by the yoke. And it is so tight on their neck that they are not able to move their head right and left. And they are not able to properly see what is in front of them, and they are not able to look down. So this is a very beautiful similitude that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given. A yoke is a chain that is wrapped around a person's neck, and sometimes they also have a handle with which they it's used to tie the hands of a person also. So that is why some of the Mufassirin have said that although it is not mentioned in the verse that their hands will be tied, but it is implied. Because in the Arabic language, ghul refers to a chain that is used to tie both the neck and the hand. So some of the Mufassirin have said that the implied tafsir of this verse is that the hand will also be tied behind their necks. So one of the similitudes in this verse is that a person whose head is who keeps his head always high, so this signifies arrogance. So one of the reasons why they are not able to accept iman is because of their arrogance and their stubbornness. So this is signifying their arrogance. And a person who's being choked by a chain, he is not able to see, he's not able to look right and left, he's not able to see what's in front of him, he's not able to look down. So this is signifying that they do not know what is harmful for them, and they are not able to see the straight path. The straight path that is in front of them, that is very visible and apparent, is not very visible and apparent to them because they are being choked by the chains. And a person who is being choked by a chain in this manner, he will not know if he falls into a ditch or a pit, if he is walking, because he cannot lower his head. So because he is not able to lower his head, he does not know whether he will fall into a ditch or not. So he cannot save himself from harm. So similarly, these disbelievers and these mushrikeen, they are not able to save themselves from destruction in the hereafter by accepting iman, because they are too ghafil, or they are too arrogant to accept the truth. And there is another tafsir of this verse that has been mentioned by Imam Razi rahimahullah in his tafsir. He mentions that there are two types of barriers. There is one type of barrier that prevents a person from seeing himself. And there is another barrier that prevents a person from seeing the things around him. So, inna ja'alna fi a'naqihim aghlalan fahiya ila al-adqani fahum muqmahun. A person whose neck is being choked and he is forced to look upwards, he is not able to look downwards. So this person is not able to even look at himself, because in order to look at himself, he has to look down. And he is not able to look down. And this also signifies that a person who is in this condition, he is not able to lower his head. So this signifies that they are too arrogant, that they are not able to lower their heads in front of the command of Allah and in front of the message of Rasulullah. They are not able to submit themselves to the message of Allah. So Imam Razi rahimahullah says that inna ja'alna fi a'naqihim aghlalan fahiya lil adqani fahum muqmahun signifies that they do not ponder over the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's power in their own existence, in their own selves, because this is something that is preventing them from even looking at themselves. And so they are not able to understand their own existence. وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. Allah says in the Quran that in yourselves there are many signs of the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will you not see? And there's a very famous saying of the mashayikh that we hear. This is not a hadith, sometimes misquoted as a hadith, but this is a saying of the mashayikh. مَنْ عَرَفَ نَفْسَهُ فَقَدْ عَرَفَ رَبَّهُ. The person who has recognized himself, he has recognized his Lord. What this means is that in order for a person to truly understand Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has to first understand what his status is. If a person does not understand why he has been created, what his status and rank is in the sight of Allah, and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects from him, how will he truly understand Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So a person first has to understand what his status is. What is his status? That every single person is a abd. We are all servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is our purpose in life? وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to please him. So once a person understands himself, he will understand his Lord. So إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا فِي أَعْنَاقِهِمْ أَغْلَالًا فَهِيَ الْأَذْقَانِ فَهُمْ مُقْمَحُونَ signifies that they do not even understand themselves. And when a person fails to truly recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes this person to forget himself. وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنفُسَهُمْ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. Do not become like those who forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and as a result of this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes them forget themselves. They forget and they become negligent of what is actually harmful and what is actually beneficial for them. And وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْ بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ سَدًّا وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ سَدًّا فَأَغْشَيْنَاهُمْ فَهُمْ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ signifies that they are not able to see anything around them because they have barriers in front of them, they have a barrier behind them, and they are veiled from all four sides, and they have a covering on their eyes. So this signifies that they are oblivious of their surroundings. So Imam Razi rahimahullah says that this signifies that they do not see the signs of the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala around them. They do not see the ad-dala'ilul afaqiyya, the universal signs of the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, سَنُرِيهِمْ آيَاتِنَا فِي الْآفَاقِ وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنُ لَهُمْ أَنَّهُ الْحَقِّ. We will show them our signs of power and greatness in the universe and in themselves until it becomes apparent to them that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the actual true being. So we are supposed to ponder over the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In one hadith, Rasulullah said, تَفَكَّرُوا فِي خَلْقِ اللَّهِ وَلَا تَفَكَّرُوا فِي اللَّهِ. ponder over the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, do not ponder over the being of Allah. Because the being of Allah cannot be truly comprehended with our limited mind. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's being is unlimited and our intellect is limited. So we cannot comprehend something which is unlimited and which is not truly comprehensible. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these two verses basically gave an example to us of their condition of being so far from iman. Now again, we should understand that apparently from these verses it seems as if they were forced to become like this because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed them to be like this. This is not the case. So we have to, when we study the Quran, we have to look at different verses and we have to look at the purpose of the verses. So the purpose of these verses are to console Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But we also have to look at the other verses that tell us that their condition, this condition of theirs, that they are not able to understand the truth, they are not able to see the truth. And some verses, in a verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَهُمْ قُلُوبٌ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ بِهَا وَلَهُمْ آذَانٌ لَا يَسْمَعُونَ بِهَا وَلَهُمْ أَعْيُنٌ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ بِهَا. They have hearts, but they do not understand with those hearts. They have eyes with which they do not see. They have ears with which they do not hear. صُمٌّ بُكْمٌ عُمْيٌ فَهُمْ لَا يَرْجِعُونَ. They are dumb, deaf, and blind. They do not understand. خَتَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَى قُلُوبِهِمْ وَعَلَى سَمْعِهِمْ وَعَلَى أَبْصَارِهِمْ غِشَاوَةً. Allah has put a seal on their hearts and on their ears, and وَعَلَىٰ أَبْصَارِهِمْ غِشَاوَةً, and there is a veil on their eyes. And وَجَعَلْنَا عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ أَكِنَّةً أَنْ يَفْقَهُوهُ وَفِي أَذَانِهِمْ مَقْرًا. We have put veils on their hearts that prevents them from understanding what we say, and there is a burden on their ears that prevents them from hearing what we say. So when we read verses like this, and we should not think, or we should not come to the conclusion that because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed them to be like this, that is why they were forced to disbelieve. They were forced to deny Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we have to read the other verses where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly indicates that this condition of their wretchedness and this condition of their hearts being sealed from accepting the truth was a cause of their disbelief, was the cause of them intentionally and willingly adopting kufr and adopting shirk and adopting a life of sin. Otherwise, in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions فِطْرَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي فَطَرَ النَّاسَ عَلَيْهَا لَا تَبْدِيلَ لِخَلْقِ اللَّهِ. This is referring to the inherent condition that a person is born in when he comes to this world. كُلُّ مَوْلُودٍ يُولَدُ عَلَى الْفِطْرَةِ. Rasulullah says in the hadith, every single child is born in this world in the state of fitra, in the natural state where a person has the inherent ability to accept the truth, do good deeds, and refrain from sins. So everyone is born with the inherent ability to do good deeds and to accept the truth. But it is afterwards in life, when they become baligh and they become mature, they willingly choose which path they want to adopt. So sometimes they follow their parents, they follow the culture, or they follow their society. But whatever religion they adopt, they willingly adopt. That is why Rasulullah said in the hadith, كُلُّ مَوْلُودٍ يُولَدُ عَلَى الْفِطْرَةِ فَأَبَوَاهُ يَهُوِّدَانِهِ أَوْ يُنَصِّرَانِهِ أَوْ يُمَجِّسَانِهِ. Every child is born in a state of fitrah, but it is afterwards that their parents turn them into Jews or Christians or fire worshippers, depending on what environment they were brought up in. But whatever they adopt willingly. That is why every single person, you know, we can make the excuse, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from making this excuse, we can make the excuse that because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed me to commit sin, that is why I'm committing sin. So, because Allah decreed and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wrote down in my taqdeer that I have to do this sin, that is why I did this sin. So we can fool ourselves and we can plead ourselves by saying this, but every single person who has some intellect or some conscience in him, he knows that when we do any deed, whether good or bad, we know that we are doing this willingly. Even a dog knows that a human being does his actions by his own will. That is why if we throw a rock at a dog, the dog does not start barking at the rock. And the dog does not start biting the rock. The dog comes after the person. Because the dog knows that this rock didn't just hit me on his own, there was someone who hit me. So every single person, when we do any deed, whether good or bad, we know that we are doing this willingly. And this is, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this in various verses in the Quran. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يَعْشُ عَنْ ذِكْرِ الرَّحْمَنِ نُقَيِّضْ لَهُ شَيْطَانًا فَهُوَ لَهُ قَرِينٌ. This comes in Surah Al-Shura. Whoever turns away from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the action of a person. This is the sabab, this is the cause. What is the result? نُقَيِّضْ لَهُ شَيْطَانًا فَهُوَ لَهُ قَرِينٌ. We appoint a devil who takes charge, who controls them. نُقَيِّضْ قَيَّضَ يُقَيِّضُ تَقِيِّضًا means to appoint someone to take in charge. So then shaitan, he takes charge of his life. فَهُوَ لَهُ قَرِينٌ, and shaitan becomes his companion. So in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not mention that we give shaitan the power to misguide him. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that first what happens is that this person turns away from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes the shaitan to become his companion. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in another verse, بَلْ طَبَعَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهَا بِكُفْرِهِمْ فَلَا يُؤْمِنُونَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. Allah has put a seal upon their hearts, بِكُفْرِهِمْ, because of their kufr, because of their disbelief. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not just put a seal on their hearts because they were decreed to disbelieve. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put a seal on their hearts because of their disbelief. So their actions became the cause of their hearts being sealed. كَلَّا بَلْ رَانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. Their hearts become rusty because of the sins that they commit. And it is a result of the rust in their hearts that prevents them from accepting the truth. So a person's heart becomes sealed when it becomes blocked and blackened through excessive sinning. So this is not the fault of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is due to the will, it is due to the actions that a person willingly does. That is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith, that إِنَّ الْعَبْدَ إِذَا أَخْطَأَ خَطِيئَةً نُكِتَتْ فِي قَلْبِهِ نُكْتَةٌ سَوْدَاءٌ. That when a person, he commits a sin, then a black spot is formed in his heart. If he makes tawbah and he refrains from that sin, سُقِلَتْ. His heart becomes clean and clear. But if he does not make tawbah and he continues to commit sins, then slowly, slowly black dots continue to form in his heart to such an extent that his whole heart becomes black. And then it becomes impossible for any khayr to enter that heart. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us from reaching that condition. وَسَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ أَأَنذَرْتَهُمْ أَمْ لَمْ تُنذِرْهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Again, this verse is also a verse that is intended to console Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it is the same for them, whether you warn them or not, they will not believe. Because they are decreed not to believe. So if they do not believe, do not become depressed. So the purpose of this verse is to console Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One thing to note in this verse is, وَسَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ. Allah said that it is the same for them, whether you warn them or not, they will not believe. Allah did not say, وَسَوَاءٌ عَلَيْكَ. It is the same for you. Because whether anyone accepts the message of Rasulullah ﷺ or not, Rasulullah ﷺ will get the benefit of conveying the message, and he will get the benefit of giving da'wah. The more da'wah a person gives, the more reward he gets. So da'wah never goes in vain. Whether a person listens to the da'i or not, the person who does not listen, he is harming himself, he is not harming the da'i at all. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is consoling Rasulullah by saying that you continue your mission and you continue giving them da'wah, you will continue getting reward, and if they do not accept you, they are harming themselves. إِنَّمَا تُنذِرُ مَنِ اتَّبَعَ الذِّكْرَ وَخَشِيَ الرَّحْمَنَ بِالْغَيْبِ فَبَشِّرُهُ بِمَغْفِرَةٍ وَأَجْرٍ كَرِيمٍ. You only warn that person who follows the advice or the reminder. Al-Dhikr is referring to the Qur'an. And who fears Ar-Rahman بِالْغَيْبِ without seeing him. فَبَشِّرُهُ بِمَغْفِرَةٍ وَأَجْرٍ كَرِيمٍ. Give him glad tidings of great forgiveness and a handsome reward. A gracious, honorable reward. So, إِنَّمَا تُنذِرُ مَنِ اتَّبَعَ الذِّكْرَ. So, Rasulullah ﷺ came as a nadir to everyone, to believers as well as the mushrikeen and the kuffar. But in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that you only warn that person who follows the reminder. Now, what does this mean? This means that only that person who follows your advice and who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will benefit from your warning and will benefit from your advice. It does not mean that Rasulullah was not sent as a warner to the mushrikeen and the kuffar. Like in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Hudal lin nas, and he says, Hudal lil muttaqeen. He says that the Quran is a guidance for the entire humanity, but at the same time, in another verse, he says that the Quran is a means of guidance for only those who fear Allah. So there is apparent contradiction between the two verses. So there is no actual contradiction. The purpose of both verses is, the purpose of Hudal lin nas is that the Quran is a guidance for everyone. But only that person who has the fear of Allah will benefit from the guidance and will accept the guidance. So Rasulullah ﷺ, he came as a warner to both the mushrikeen, kuffar, and the mu'mineen. But only that person who actually fears Allah will follow his advice and will benefit from his advice. So this is what is meant by this verse. إِنَّمَا تُنذِرُ مَنِ اتَّبَعَ الذِّكْرَ وَخَشِيَ الرَّحْمَنَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Another thing to note in this verse is وَخَشِيَ الرَّحْمَنَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Allah uses his attribute Ar-Rahman. He didn't say وَخَشِيَ اللَّهَ بِالْغَيْبِ. And he did not use an attribute that is used for punishment, like وَخَشِيَ شَدِيدَ الْعِقَابِ بِالْغَيْبِ. And he fears the one who is severe in punishment without seeing him. But Allah uses an attribute of mercy. So Rahma, the attribute of mercy, dictates that a person should have mercy in Allah, not fear him. A being who is merciful, a person who shows mercy, We should have hope in the mercy of Allah. We should not fear Him. So what is the connection between khashiya and rahma? Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose the sifa ar-Rahman instead of something like shadidul iqab or al-qahhar or al-aziz? So the Mufassirin have mentioned that the benefit or the nukta behind this is that when we say that we have hope in the mercy of Allah, what does that mean? So when we say I have hope in the mercy of Allah, it should not only be lip service. So the meaning of having hope in the mercy of Allah is not that a person says, oh, Allah is Ghafur Rahim, Allah will forgive me, Allah is all merciful, I can do whatever I want, I can disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whenever I want, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Ghafur Rahim. This is not the meaning of rahmah. This is not the meaning of having hope in the mercy of Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Luqman, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنَّ وَعْدَ اللَّهِ حَقٌّ فَلَا تَغُرَّنَّكُمُ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا وَلَا يَغُرَّنَّكُمْ بِاللَّهِ الْغُرُورِ. O human beings, verily the promise of Allah is true. What that means is verily Akhirah will come. فَلَا تَغُرَّنَّكُمُ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا. So never let the worldly life deceive you. وَلَا يَغُرَّنَّكُمْ بِاللَّهِ الْغُرُورِ. And do not let the great deceiver, the shaitan, the devil, do not ever let him deceive you regarding Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the tafsir of وَلَا يَغُرَّنَّكُمْ بِاللَّهِ الْغُرُورِ is do not let shaitan deceive you into thinking that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ghafoor rahim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all forgiving, all merciful. I can commit how many sins I want, I can just make tawbah afterwards and Allah will forgive me. So this is not the meaning of having hope in the mercy of Allah. This is actually making a mockery of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what is the actual meaning of having hope in the mercy of Allah? Having hope in the mercy of Allah means that a person adopts the means that makes him deserving of receiving the mercy of Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala indicates this matter in Surah Al-Baqarah. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَالَّذِينَ هَاجَرُوا وَجَاهَدُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أُولَٰئِكَ يَرْجُونَ رَحْمَةَ اللَّهِ. Verily those who believe and they migrate for the sake of Allah and they strive with their lives and their wealth, أُولَٰئِكَ يَرْجُونَ رَحْمَةَ اللَّهِ. They are the true servants who have hope in the mercy of Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the actions that the servants who have real hope in the mercy of Allah, Allah mentioned their action, that they have iman, and they are ready to leave their homes for the sake of Allah, and they are ready to sacrifice their lives and their wealth for the sake of Allah. So that is why وَخَشْيَ الرَّحْمَانُ was brought. That Ar-Rahman indicates that they have hope in the mercy of Allah, but their hope in the mercy of Allah does not lead them to not having fear in Allah. So iman is in between having hope in the mercy of Allah and being fearful of his punishment. So when a person has hope in the mercy of Allah, this encourages him to do good deeds. And when he has fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this prevents him from committing sins. So that is why having hope in the mercy of Allah and fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, both are important. And bil ghaib means without seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So despite not seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he still fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And another tafsir of bil ghaib is he fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in solitude, in seclusion. A person's taqwa is truly tested when he is alone, when no one is seeing him, when he is alone and there is no one to see what he is doing. That is when a person's taqwa is truly tested. So وَخَشِيَ الرَّحْمَانَ بِالْغَيْبِ means a person who fears Allah in seclusion and in solitude. And from the hadith we learn that a person who remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in solitude and he cries out of the fear of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him his shade on the day of judgment when there will be no other shade besides the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. سَبْعَةٌ يُظِلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي ظِلِّهِ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّهُ. There are seven people who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will shade on the day when there will be no other shade besides the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَرَجُلٌ ذَكَرَ اللَّهَ خَالِيًا فَفَاضَتْ عَيْنَاهُ. One of those individuals will be that person who remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in solitude, and out of the fear and love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, tears flow from his eyes. فَبَشِّرْهُ بِمَغْفِرَةٍ وَأَجْرٍ كَرِيمٍ. So give glad tidings to this person of a great forgiveness and a gracious reward. إِنَّا نَحْنُ نُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى وَنَكْتُبُ مَا قَدَّمُوا وَآثَارَهُمْ وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ أَحْصَيْنَاهُ فِي إِمَامٍ مُبِينٍ. Verily we will bring the dead back alive, and we write down whatever they sent forth, and their legacies, and the trails that they leave behind. وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ أَحْصَيْنَاهُ فِي إِمَامٍ مُبِينٍ. And we enumerate, or we meticulously enumerate or record every single thing in the clear book. وَنَكْتُبُ مَا قَدَّمُوا. And we write down whatever they sent forth. That means we write down whatever deed they do, whether good or bad. So Allah did not say وَنَكْتُبُ مَا عَمِلُوا. We write down whatever they do. Allah used the word مَا قَدَّمُوا. Because whatever deed we do in this world, it does not finish here. But whatever deed we do, it will go with us to the grave, and whatever deed we do is recorded in our book of deeds. So on the day of judgment, we will either see the reward of our good deeds or we will see the punishment of our bad deeds. So that is why Allah uses the verse مَا قَدَّمُوا, whatever you send forth for yourself in the hereafter. So whatever action we do, whether good or bad, is sent to the hereafter in our book of deeds. وآثارهم. آثار, the translation that was given here, along with their legacies of good or evil. Athar basically refers to the actions that we become the cause of, whether good or bad. So if a person becomes the cause of any good action, so whoever will follow in his footsteps and whoever will do a good deed because of him, he will get all of the reward. And on the contrary, if someone becomes a cause of any sin taking place, whoever will commit that sin because of him, he will get the full sin of it. So Rasulullah said in a hadith, "Man sanna fil Islami sunnatan hasanatan, falahu ajruha wa ajru man amila biha min ghayri an yunqasa min ujurihim shay'un." Whoever initiates a good action in Islam, he will get the full reward of it, and he will get the full reward of anyone who practices upon it, without their rewards being diminished at all. And on the contrary, وَمَنْ سَنَّ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ سُنَّةً سَيِّئَةً فَلَهُ وِزْرُهَا وَوِزْرُ مَنَ عَمِلَ بِهَا مِنْ غَيْرِ أَيُّنْ قَسَ مِنْ أَوْزَارِهِمْ شَيْءٌ. And whoever initiates a evil action, then he will get the sin of it and the sin of everyone who practices upon it without anyone's sin being diminished. Everyone, the perpetrator and the one who became the cause of the sin, will get full sin. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this in the Quran also. وَلَا يَحْمِلُنَّ أَثْقَالَهُمْ وَأَثْقَالًا مَعَ أَثْقَالِهِمْ. They will come with their burdens of sin and with the burden of sins of those individuals who became astray because of them. So we should always strive to become a means of guidance and not a means of misguidance. Rasulullah said in a hadith, طُوبَى لِعَبْدٍ جَعَلَهُ اللَّهُ مِفْتَاحًا لِلْخَيْرِ وَمِغْلَاقًا لِلْشَّرِ وَوَيْلٌ لِمَنْ جَعَلَهُ اللَّهُ مِفْتَاحًا لِلْشَّرِ وَمِغْلَاقًا لِلْخَيْرِ. Glad tidings to a person who Allah uses as a key to open the doors of good, and Allah uses him as a lock to lock down evil deeds. And woe and destruction be to that person who Allah uses as a key to open the doors of evil, and Allah uses them as a lock to lock down good deeds. And from the hadith we learn that there are certain actions that if a person does, he will receive the reward of it even after he goes to his grave. إِذَا مَاتَ الْإِنسَانِ إِنْقَطَعْ عَمَلُهُ إِلَّا مِنْ ثَلَاثِ صَدَقَةٍ جَارِيَةٍ أَوْ عِلْمٍ يُنْتَفَعُ بِهِ أَوْ وَلَدٍ صَالِحٍ يَدْعُو لَهُ. That when a person passes away, his actions come to an end. What that means is that he no more receives the rewards of his good actions because he is not able to do any good actions anymore. Illa min thalath, but there are three such things, the reward of which goes to his grave. Sadaqatin jariyah, perpetual sadaqah. Perpetual sadaqah is any charity that a person gives and the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is benefiting from it. For example, a person, he planted a tree. This also comes in the hadith in Riyad al-Salihin. A person planted a tree. So whichever creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala eats from the fruits of that tree, or they benefit from the shade of that tree, or they benefit from the tree in any manner, this person will get the reward. And it is always better to make intention. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. Because some of the muhaddithin say that a person will get reward if he makes intention. Although in the hadith, this condition has not been laid down. But as a believer, we are not supposed to do any action without a good intention. So sadaqatin jariyah could also refer to someone building a masjid, building a madrasa, building or writing a beneficial book, or building an orphanage, or building a place for travelers to stay for free when they come to any place, or digging a well or a river. Anything that becomes the means of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, taking benefit from, will be regarded to be sadaqatun jariyah. أَوْ عِلْمٌ يُنْتَفَعُ بِهِ, or he leaves behind knowledge that people are benefiting from. So either he taught people or he wrote a beneficial book that people are benefiting from. So for example, if someone, he teaches someone the kalima, or teaches someone how to perform salah. So as long as that person recites the kalima, as long as that person is performing salah, he will get full reward of it. أو ولد صالح يدعو له, or a religious child who makes dua for his father or his parent. So these three things are such things that a person receives the reward of it after he goes to his grave. Some of the muhaddithin like Mullah Ali Qari and the commentator of Kanz al-Daqaiq is a book of Hanafi fiqh. There is a commentary of this book, Ma'adin al-Haqaiq. So in the footnotes of this book is written that a scholar is able to achieve all three things. If a person becomes a scholar, he is able to achieve all three things. So he goes on to explain, صَدَقَةٌ جَارِيَةٌ عِلْمٌ يُنْتَفَعُ بِهِ, because the knowledge that a person conveys to other people and the knowledge that people benefit from is a صَدَقَةٌ جَارِيَةٌ itself. So if a scholar does not have anything as a صَدَقَةٌ جَارِيَةٌ in his account, his knowledge that he leaves behind is صَدَقَةٌ جَارِيَةٌ for him. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives someone the tawfiq to build a madrasa, a masjid, then nurun ala nur. But if someone does not get this opportunity, just the knowledge that he imparts to people will be a sadaqatun jariyah for him. And then he goes on to explain, a waladun salihun yad'u lahu. So waladun salihun refers to biological son and spiritual sons also. So whoever teaches anyone, whichever scholar, the students of a scholar are his spiritual sons. And we all know that one of the etiquettes of being a student of knowledge is that the student should always make dua for his teacher. And we heard from our teachers and our elders, there are two individuals whose right you can never fulfill. And they are the parents and your religious teachers. You can never fulfill their right. We cannot fulfill the right of our parents, obviously. Their favors upon us are so great. They are the reason why we came into this world. And the favor of the teacher is great, because if it was not for the teacher, then we would not have known who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, who Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is. We would not have known what is halal, what is haram, what makes us close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and what makes us far from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why some of our mashayikh have said that although the rights of the parents are more than the religious teacher, and this status has been given to them by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself in the Quran, that the status and the rank of the parents comes after Allah and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But from one perspective, the favor of the religious teacher is greater than the parent. Because the parent is the cause of the physical nourishment of the child, and the religious teacher is the cause of the spiritual nourishment and the spiritual salvation of the student. And salvation in the Akhirah is the actual salvation. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward all of our teachers for all of their sacrifice and for them teaching us, and for being the cause of us being here. وَآثَارَهُمْ, another tafsir of وَآثَارَهُمْ, آثَار also means footsteps. So another tafsir of this verse is that we write down your footsteps. So basically in one tafsir it comes that this refers to the footstep that a person takes towards the masjid. As it comes in hadith that there were some areas that were vacant close to the Masjid al-Nabawi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the tribe of Banu Salima, they intended to buy houses close to the masjid so that they can be close to the masjid. The house was a bit far from the masjid. So when Rasulullah sallam heard of this, he said, Diyarakum tuktabu atharukum, Diyarakum tuktabu atharukum, Diyarakum tuktabu atharukum. That stay in your houses, your footsteps towards the masjid is written for you. Stay in your houses, the reward of the footsteps that you take toward the masjid is written for you. So it does not only refer to the footsteps that are taken towards the masjid, it refers to any footstep that is taken towards any good deed. And وَآثَارُهُمْ also refers to any footstep that is taken towards committing any sin. وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ نَحْصَيْنَاهُ فِي إِمَامٍ مُبِينٍ And we meticulously enumerate or record everything in the clear book. Fi imamin mubin. Imam is someone who is followed. So the reason why imamin mubin is referring to the Allah al-Mahfuz, the protected tablet. So in this verse, the purpose of this verse is to show that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not in need of writing down a person's deed. A person's deed is written down in his book of deeds after the action occurs. But before the occurrence of the action, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already written it down in the Allah al-Mahfuz. The taqdeer of every single matter is written before it occurs in the Allah al-Mahfuz fil azal. And the other meaning of Imam-i Mubin is the book of deeds. So the reason why the Allah al-Mahfuz or the book of deeds is referred to as Imam is because the Allah al-Mahfuz is followed in deciding the decree of the creation of Allah. And the reason why the book of deeds is referred to as Imam is because this book will be followed in deciding whether a person should be put in Jannah or Jahannam. As Allah says in the Quran, that وَنُخْرِجُ لَهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ كِتَابٍ يَلْقَاهُ مَنْشُورًا. We will take out for him on the Day of Judgment a book which he will find open, and Allah will tell him, اِقْرَأْ كِتَابَكَ. Read your book of deeds. كَفَى بِنَفْسِكَ الْيَوْمَ عَلَيْكَ حَسِيبًا. You are sufficient and you are enough to take account of yourself. You can decide for yourself where you belong, whether you belong in Jannah or Jahannam. And the reason why Mubin was brought, that the clear book of deeds or the clear book of tablet, is because all of our deeds in our book of deeds will be written clearly, and all of the details of our action will be written clearly. We might forget what action we did, but it will be preserved in our book of deeds. So we cannot deny it on the Day of Judgment that I do not remember doing this. يَوْمَ يَبْعَثُهُمُ اللَّهُ جَمِيعًا فَيُنَبِّئُهُمْ بِمَا عَمِلُوا أَحْصَاهُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. The day when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will resurrect everyone, and He will inform everyone of the deeds that they did. أَحْصَاهُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. Allah keeps count of everything, وَنَسُوهُ, although they forget. So Allah, everything will be written down in our book of deeds. And in the Quran also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that when the sinner will be given his book of deeds, he will be astonished by how much detail there is of every single action that he did. He will say, يَا وَيْلَتَنَا مَالِ هَذَا الْكِتَابِ لَا يُغَادِرُ صَغِيرَةً وَلَا كَبِيرَةً إِلَّا أَحْصَاهَا. That woe, what is the matter with this book? It has not left behind any minor sin or major sin, but that it has preserved it. So every single action of a person will be recorded in his book of deeds. We make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gives us the tawfiq to send beneficial deeds in the hereafter, and He gives us the tawfiq to do such actions, the rewards of which we will receive in our graves after we leave this world. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alamin.